Hi, my name's Laura and I'm going to be running the session today. So hello again to everyone who participated in our previous sessions and welcome to those of you who are watching for the first time. It's good to have you with us. Now today's session is aimed at people who are living with mild to moderate dementia. The activities today will help us with focus and attention as well as boosting our memories and our thinking. This session is designed to be used with family members, caregivers and friends, so please do ask them to join us for this if you'd like. Now today's session will be broken down into three parts. We'll do some holiday reminiscence in Brighton to begin with, then some art appreciation and questions and songs from the shows to finish. You might like to keep a notepad beside you to jot down any answers to questions that you come up with. So if you have any questions yourself or require further information, then please do type into the comments box below and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. So if you've just joined us, this session is aimed at people who are living with mild to moderate stage dementia. The session is designed for caregivers and family members to participate in, but if it's not possible for you to be together just now due to the current circumstances, then perhaps you could both watch it separately and then discuss it later. So again, the session is going to be broken down into three parts. We'll be doing some holiday reminiscence to begin with, then we'll have some art appreciation with questions, followed by songs from the shows to finish. Remember, the session can be paused at any time and rewatched as many times as you like. So let's get started. So let's think about some holidays that we might have had by the sea. So holidays at the seaside were really popular in Great Britain in the 1950s and 60s. By this time, most British workers had at least 2 weeks paid holiday per year, and millions of people went to the beach for their holidays every year. In fact, even by 1975, 40 million people visited the towns on the British coast for a break. Where people chose to go often depended largely on where they lived. So if you lived in the north, you might have gone to Blackpool or Morecambe, and if you lived further south, you might have chosen Brighton or Margate. Did you ever visit the seaside? Where did you go? And if you did go, where did you stay? Some people stayed with friends or rented a house, maybe a bed and breakfast or hotel, and holiday camps like Butlins or Pontins were also really popular. We used to go to Blackpool on holiday when I was little and we visited all the attractions there, but today we'll be visiting Brighton. So Brighton Beach is famous for being really rocky, so there perhaps weren't too many sandcastles being built there, but there were plenty of other things to do. So families could relax on rented deck chairs or maybe shelter behind windbreaks in between going for a swim or paddle in the sea. There were beach huts which you could also rent for a day or longer, and these came in really handy for getting changed out of your swimming costume as well as from hiding from the rain if a shower came on. There were donkey rides for the children, and if you were hungry you could have fish and chips or maybe some cockles and whelks and candy floss. Now people could take walks up and down the promenade at Brighton and perhaps go and see what was happening on Brighton's famous Palace Pier. So this is still Brighton's most popular tourist attraction, and right up until 2015 it was still receiving over 4 million visitors a year. It was the third pier in Brighton to be built, and it was completed 121 years ago in 1899. It's over 1700 feet long, and that's the equivalent of 65 double-decker buses. It was closed during the Second World War to prevent enemy troops from using it as a landing point. Now, when this pier was built, its main aim was for it to be used as a place for pleasure. And a music hall was added in 1911 and played host to all manner of stars, including Stan Laurel from the comedy duo Laurel and Hardy, and also Charlie Chaplin played there at the very beginning of his career. So basically, all the popular entertainers of the day would play on the pier, and many famous historical visitors have been known to take a walk there, including Greta Garbo, Winston Churchill, and Grace Kelly. Okay, so the final stop on our tour is at the iconic Brighton Pavilion, also known as the Royal Pavilion. So the building of the pavilion began in 1787, and it was to be used as a seaside retreat for the future King George IV. It was built in the style which became very popular in India and continued to be so for most of the following century. Now, the King enjoyed all of the entertainment that was on offer in Brighton and was also told that the fresh air and seawater would be beneficial for his health. Later on, when Queen Victoria was the monarch, she sold the pavilion to the town, as Brighton was becoming a very popular tourist destination, even in the 1840s, and she didn't like the lack of privacy that the crowds brought. So another key point in the pavilion's history came during the First World War, when it was transformed into a military hospital for soldiers from the Indian Corps. It had 720 beds and over 2,000 men were treated at the hospital there. The soldiers came from many different backgrounds and there were 9 different kitchens in the grounds to help cater for people's different cultural and religious needs. By 1860, the stables at the pavilion were converted into a concert hall, which is now known as the Brighton Dome, and it is still used as a concert venue today. Have you ever been to a concert at the Dome? And the beautiful gardens at the pavilion continue to be a big draw for visitors. They have a wide variety of plants there, which are maintained by the council and the volunteers, and it's done completely organically. In the summer, the garden is often used by street entertainers, so the crowds have plenty to hear and see as they walk around the gardens. So the glory days of the British seaside holiday sadly came to an end with the arrival of cheap package tour holidays abroad. But it's good to know that places by the sea, like Brighton, continue to be popular and still attract many visitors to enjoy everything that they have to offer. I hope that you enjoyed our trip around Brighton today. So let's have a look at some of the most famous paintings in the world. We can have a think about what we like or don't like about them, and also how they might make us feel. And remember, if you'd like to stop the video at any time to discuss the different paintings, you can. So let's begin with what many people consider to be the most famous piece of art in the world. What do you think the most famous painting in the world is? Well, in terms of being the most frequently searched piece of art on the internet and one of the most visited pieces of art, it must be the Mona Lisa. So it was painted at the start of the 16th century by the multi-skilled genius Leonardo da Vinci. And it's been displayed in the Louvre in Paris for the last 200 years. Have you ever been to see it for yourself? Well, over 30,000 people a day have gone to see it. What do you think of this painting? Now, she's famous for her mysterious smile, and critics notice that she seems to smile more when you look at her eyes instead of her mouth. If you look only at her mouth, she appears to be much more serious. It's quite an interesting effect. What do you think? Let's have a look at another piece of art. This is another piece by an Italian artist, and it was created about the same time as the Mona Lisa. Have you seen this one before? It's called The Creation of Adam, and it was painted by Michelangelo. And it forms part of a much larger piece of work based on the first book of the Bible. So where can you see this artwork? Where can you see The Creation of Adam by Michelangelo? Well, you can find this artwork on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel at the Vatican in Rome. Now, it's one of the most replicated religious paintings of all time. What do you think of it? Now, Michelangelo and his assistants used scaffolding to paint the ceiling of the chapel, and not surprisingly, it caused him severe backache. Now, the Sistine Chapel has been visited by 25,000 visitors a day, with staff constantly asking people to be quiet in the chapel, and the silence never lasts for very long. Let's have a look at another painting. So who was the artist who painted these sunflowers? Which artist painted a series of sunflowers like this? That's right, it was Vincent van Gogh. Now his sunflowers are so popular with their bright colours. Do you like them? Let's hear a bit more about the artist's life from Colin Wiggins at the National Gallery.
Well, let's think about Vincent first of all and his biography. His story is so well known, we can whoosh through it. He's born in a little town called Nuenen in the Netherlands. His father is a Protestant pastor. He spent about the first 30 years of his life failing at everything. He was pretty old when he got started. The earliest painting that we have by Vincent in our collection comes from his first serious campaign of work. It's the one over in the corner there, the head of a peasant woman. He was getting on for 30 when he painted that picture. And that's quite old to have your artistic career starting. And 6 or 7 years later, he's gone. So his career is incredibly short. And I think it's as well to remind ourselves how short his working life was, especially when you compare him to other iconic artists in this collection, like Turner or Michelangelo or Rembrandt or Titian particularly. Vincent is like a meteor, whoosh, and he's gone.
Now, Van Gogh certainly burned brightly, and he created some other dazzling and popular works of art, including Starry Night. So let's have a look at our next piece of art. Now these are water lilies painted by Claude Monet, and they formed part of a huge series that he painted in the last 30 years of his life, a total of over 250 oil paintings. Now these paintings are amongst the most recognised and popular works of art in the 20th century and were hugely influential to other upcoming artists. Now what type of art is this an example of? What school of art was Monet at the forefront of? That's right, Impressionism. In fact, the whole artistic movement of Impressionism took its name from one of his paintings. It's a more abstract way of representing objects. What do you think about this type of painting? Now, Monet gave a set of these water lily paintings to the French government as a symbol of peace at the end of the First World War. Now let's have a look at our final piece of artwork. So this is a famous example of the pop art movement in the 20th century, and it's of Campbell's soup cans. So which artist produced Campbell's soup cans? Who was responsible for producing this artwork? That's right, it was Andy Warhol. And these paintings were first exhibited in 1962 and featured each of the canned soup varieties that the company were making at the time. Now, it caused a huge controversy over where this could truly be called art due to the commercial nature of its subject matter. What do you think? Do you think that it qualifies as being art? Now, I really like the bright colours and enjoy a lot of Andy Warhol's work. Campbell Soup Company still exists and continues to produce some of these famous varieties of soup today. Well, I hope you enjoyed looking at and thinking about these five famous and very different pieces of art from the last 500 years with me. So let's listen to some songs from the shows. Did you ever go to the theatre to see a musical or maybe watch them at the cinema? Now, all the musicals that we're talking about today began on the stage before being made into films, apart from one, and we'll come to that one right at the end. So let's see what we can remember about some of these famous shows. We'll start by going back in time to a story which was set in London in 1912. Now it's about Eliza Doolittle, who was a Cockney flower girl who got speech lessons. Do you know what the film is? So it was first performed on Broadway in 1956 and then was made into a film in 1964. What do you think? That's right, it was My Fair Lady. So let's have a look at one of the famous songs from that musical, I Could Have Danced All Night.
I could have danced all night, I could have danced all night, and still have begged for more. I could have spread my wings and done a thousand things I've never done before. I'll never know what made it so.
Did you know it? I wonder if you recognise the actress who played Eliza Doolittle in the film. Who played Eliza Doolittle in the film version of My Fair Lady? That's right, it was Audrey Hepburn. So it was originally Julie Andrews on the stage. We might see a bit more of Julie Andrews later, but it was Audrey Hepburn in the film version. Interestingly, the filmmakers didn't think she was a good enough singer for her voice to be used in the film, and her singing was actually dubbed. So this next song is one of the most successful songs ever from a musical, and it won an Ivor Novello Award for Best Song in 1982. It was famously sung by Elaine Page, and it was based on a poem by T.S. Eliot. In fact, his poems formed the basis of the whole musical. Do you think that you know what it is? Let's have a listen.
Memory all alone.
So that beautiful song was Memory, sung by Elaine Page. Do you know what musical this song came from? What musical did the song Memory come from? That's right, it was Cats. So it was written by Andrew Lloyd Webber, and it's the sixth longest running West End show. It ran for 21 years. And it was really popular when it first came out in the 1980s. And I can remember singing songs from this musical when I was at school. And I think I might also have been dressed as a cat, but that's another story. Cats is still really popular today. And it was made into a film last year starring Judi Dench. Let's have a listen to the next song.
Well, hello.
Look who's here.
Darling. This is Lewis.
Hello, Lewis.
Darling, it's so nice to have you back where you belong.
I am so glad to be back.
Are you looking swell?
Thank you, Lewis.
Darling, I can tell.
Does it show?
Darling, you still glowing. You still growing. You still
going strong.
I feel the room.
And
the band. One of our favorite songs,
remembering
so
it was my favorite.
Show some snap, fellas. Find an empty love, darling. Never go away again.
So that was Hello Dolly from the musical of the same name, performed here by Louis Armstrong and Barbara Streisand. I really love the sound of Louis Armstrong's voice, and it always makes me feel really happy to hear him sing. So Hello Dolly was first performed on Broadway in 1964, and it was then made into a film 5 years later. I wonder if you know who directed this film? Who directed Hello Dolly? It was, in fact, directed by one of the stars from the musical Singing in the Rain. So was it either A, Gene Kelly, B, Debbie Reynolds, or C, Sid Charisse? What do you think? Who directed Hello Dolly? Well, the answer is Gene Kelly. And this film was a massive success and it won an Oscar for Best Musical Score. This next musical was written by one of the most famous musical theatre partnerships of all time, Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein. This was the second musical that they wrote together, and it debuted on Broadway in 1945. The film version came out in 1956, starring Gordon McRae and Shirley Jones. Do you know what the musical could be? That's right, it's Carousel. So let's have a listen to one of the most famous songs from this musical, You'll Never Walk Alone.
When you walk through a storm, hold your head up high and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of the storm is a golden star.
Oh, it's such a powerful and moving song, and it's used as an anthem by one of the football clubs in Great Britain. Do you know which one it is? Which football club has You'll Never Walk Alone as their anthem? That's right, it's Liverpool. And this song is still so popular and well-loved today. In fact, it made number one again in the UK charts just a few weeks ago, sung by the 100-year-old Army veteran, Captain Tom Moore. Let's finish now with a song from Mary Poppins. Now, this is the only musical on the list which was a film before it was a stage show. The original film came out in 1964, and there was a sequel starring Emily Blunt as Mary Poppins 2 years ago. Can you remember who played Mary Poppins in the original film? Who played Mary Poppins? She also famously played another nanny in The Sound of Music. That's right, it was Julie Andrews. So let's finish with one of the most famous songs from Mary Poppins, Let's Go Fly a Kite.
Let's go fly a kite up to the highest height. Let's go fly a kite and send it soaring up through the atmosphere, up where the air is clear.
When you send it flying up there, all at once you're lighter than air. You can dance on the breeze over houses and trees with your pistol and tight to the string of your kite.
No!
Well, thank you so much for joining me for this journey through songs from the shows. I hope you enjoyed hearing and seeing the performances of these great songs again. It's important that we all continue to take care, to live well, and to live safely. Well, thank you so much for joining us for this session. I hope you enjoyed taking part as much as I did presenting it to you. At Care Visions, it's really important to us to keep on improving and find out how we can provide a better experience for you all. And we'd really appreciate it if you could please take a couple of minutes to provide some feedback through our feedback survey. The link for this is in the comments box below. We'll be uploading new sessions on a regular basis, so please do keep checking our website to see the latest information. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on both Facebook and Twitter. We look forward to connecting with you again next time. Take care. Bye-bye.